A towel-waving frenzy inside of Mellon Arena. Game two of the Eastern Conference Final, all yours on Versus. The Netminders tonight, Martin Perron knows he needs to be better than those 17 stops that he authored in game one. At the opposite end of the rink, Marc-Andre Fleury was called on to make 26 saves. Many of them were spectacular, although to hear him say it, his defense is doing all they need to do in front of him, Darren.
Playing very well. Getty Malkin leading the way in game one, as was his counterpart, really, already an assistant captain, Mike Richards. We featured them in the open for good reason.
Expect both of them to be center stage tonight as we are with you with more Stanley Cup playoff action on Versus, available in high definition. Joe Beninati, Darren Elliott upstairs, Chris Simpson ringside. Pittsburgh here at home, where they've won 14 straight, including the regular season. They're dressed in black. Randy Jones teamed up with Darian Hatcher in the back line. As Carter weaves in, he'll fire early. It's booted away by Marc-Andre Fleury. As Jones works with Hatcher again, we underline the change in the Philadelphia back line at the outset of the series when they got the news about Kimmo Tiimonen. Darian Hatcher was the only Flyer practically who took the day off yesterday. As we look at our Radio Shack keys to the game.
Rest was key for him in this game. No doubt they have to manage the puck better. Too many turnovers. Pittsburgh, they want to protect home ice. They need an energy boost. They know it's going to be tougher in game two. And both teams looking for the skating game, Joe. Philadelphia, from the standpoint without the puck, putting pressure, closing the gaps. And Pittsburgh, when they have the puck.
Both teams with some questions about the ice surface. Mellon Arena, the oldest facility in the National Hockey League. A rainy day throughout. The Flyers were saying that this building, perhaps the warmest in the league. They were going through a lot of changes of underwear in game one.
And they changed their defense pairings. Coburn played in the first game with Darian Hatcher, who was out there with Jason Smith for that shift.
Jordan Staal on the move, ahead for Tyler Kennedy. He did not get it deep. Lassi Kukkonen was stationed there for the Flyers. Benny Prosper looking to make a break down the wing, and Sergei Gonchar collars him. Malkin twists it on around. Ryan Malone will usher it back to center, and there's Braden Coburn, the smooth skating Flyer rear guard, to play it on ahead. Hartnell will deflect it in. Fleury calls for Gonchar to come back, and then he'll swivel it on around. Sikora down the wing for Malkin. The trailer is Malone with a wrister that was denied. Peter Sikora got the scoring started for Pittsburgh a couple nights back. He's scored in all three game ones of Pittsburgh's series in the playoffs. Here he hooks and connects with Malkin. Measured there by Richards, who makes the takeaway, then gets creamed by Malone.
Saw him coming, though.
Gill with a blast. Ooh, that caught a Flyer up high. Coburn is in need of attention. Braden Coburn with a couple of hands right to his face.
Everybody immediately stopped and motioned to the bench.
Flyers athletic trainer, strength and conditioning coach Jim McCrossin off the bench very, very quickly. You can see the telltale signs of blood on the ice as Coburn was hit up high.
Deflected shot, nothing the defenseman can do to react to that, obviously. And very classy here in Pittsburgh. Giving Braden Coburn an ovation. Sign of courage. There's Coburn battling, as he often does, full attention on Evgeny Malkin, not even really aware of where the puck was. Joe, aware at least from the standpoint where it was, and it gets deflected off the stick right up into Braden Coburn's face. Stopped it immediately. John Stevens loses his best defenseman.
That one ramped up off of Peter Sikora, who is cruising through the shooting lane. It's just amazing, Darren, this game is played at such a high speed. This doesn't happen more often.
Right, and there's Coburn, full attention on Malkin, which is his job. Knew the puck was on the point, didn't know that it was getting ramped up off the stick of Peter Sikora.
J. just 2 minutes or thereabouts into this game two. In the aftermath of game one, we prepared some notes for you, a little refresher on what occurred 48 hours ago.
Scoring first, more important than home ice. You can't tell the Pittsburgh Penguins that, though. They have yet to lose on home ice in these playoffs. Flyers, though, have reason for concern. Not really, because they've lost all game one. They've been able to come back and win game two in the previous series.
Sidney Crosby's had a bunch of assists in this Stanley Cup playoff spring. He fashioned a goal for himself in the first period back on Friday. And now this Flyers back line, which is already down all-star Kimmo Tiiminen, is going to be without Braden Coburn for a while.
Darian Hatcher going to have to shoulder a bigger load. You can post it on Braden Coburn's prognosis. Possible return, we're hopeful.
Randy Jones will spin it on around. Even strength and 5-on-5 for these two squads. Philadelphia with the game's only shot on net to this point. 41-year-old Gary Roberts muscled there by Hatcher. Larocque trying to stuff it at the post. Biron covering the lower third of the cage. Jeff Carter there in a duel. A trickle screen to veteran winger Mike Knubel. He didn't get it out. Roberts turns back behind the net. You watch Carter tangle with him, make the takeaway, and start Upshaw down the flank. Chris Letang came over to cover and works in back with Ryan Whitney. And as this game progresses, Darren, Whitney and Letang will keep a special eye on them. It's an unusual deep pairing.
It is. Two puck-moving defensemen. They're backing the fourth line. Gary Roberts, his playoff numbers. Maybe a little bit of a dying breed here, Joe. A two-way player. I talked about Mike Richards and where he is under 25 years old. Best two-way player. Gary Roberts, kind of in that same mold. You tough, throw down if you have to. Physical presence, score, do anything it takes to win. And it just seems like there's not as many guys like that, veteran-wise, that will be able to stay in the game as long playing that brand of hockey.
In his age group, or thereabouts, I think of Ranger winger Brendan Shanahan and the way he came through the ranks in very similar manner.
Very much so, because you have to remember Brendan Shanahan was pretty much a puncher. He became a real good goal scorer, but he came in as a tough as much as anything else. Learned to be a good player.
Moving towards the four-minute mark, scoreless Eastern Conference Final. Game two exclusively on Versus here at Mellon Arena in Pittsburgh. Jones chops one off the defender there. That's Hossa. The centering pass bounced in the air, and Pascal Dupuis will exit the zone for Pittsburgh. Hossa, poke check by Jones. Counterattack. Richards 2-on-3. No numbers advantage. He tried to get it deep.
That's critical. That's one of the things they didn't do a good job of in game one, the Flyers. Turning it over between the offensive blue line and the top of the offensive faceoff circles.
This is offside against Pittsburgh. No score in this hockey game, and George Larocque moments ago.
Last hit there.
Ow.
Letang, Whitney get the good D to D. They get it up to the winger. He shoots it in. There you go. He shoots it in the bench and then follows it up with some verbal volleys as well.
Well, you know he took some not-so-playful ribbing for dumping that one in so high.
Nice shot. Yeah. Good accuracy.
That's exactly what you're going to hear.
Well.
And worse.
Cleaned up, and here we go.
Gloves go down. It's Upshaw and Kennedy in the center ring.
Bantam weights.
It was all Kennedy early. Upshaw coming back.
They wanted some more. And this is a boil over and a carryover from the end of game one.
A great scrap. Scotty Upshaw for Philadelphia. Tyler Kennedy for Pittsburgh. And they hear it inside of Mellon Arena.
Upshaw, Kennedy. Not the biggest guys, but both very game. Upshaw, 6'1", 197. Tyler Kennedy, 5'11", 183. Tail of the tape. But that doesn't measure the heart or the haymakers.
Matching majors for fighting doled out at 349. Scotty Upshaw.
Uh-oh.
Philadelphia's hero from Game 5 in the Montreal series. As now George LaRocque toes the right wing. Sammy Kapanen will not be whispering in his ear anytime soon. He'd be giving away about 60 pounds.
You need a stepladder to whisper in his ear anyway.
Modry ahead for Jim Dowd and off of his boot. We're just past the four-minute mark as Fleury makes the stop on Kapanen. Dowd keeps it below the goal line. Whoa, huge hit coming there. Steve Downey inserted into the lineup and making his presence felt right away. Centering feed from Roberts came on by. Downey really clobbered Letang back behind the net. We get a whistle here.
Well, Talbot, who's in the game as well, first game back after breaking his foot. He went hard to the blue paint. This kind of activity, you knew that, Joe, that this was going to be the mood of game two. And certainly, this is what Philadelphia wanted to bring to game two. But Pittsburgh wants
to
answer.
Pittsburgh penalty to number 27, 2 minutes for roughing.
That the voice of referee Kelly Sutherland.
There it is, in tandem
with Dan O'Halloran.
Good get by our guys. It was right at the top of the paint. George LaRocque crossed the line. John Stevens happy to see LaRocque throw the only rabbit punch in the scrum.
Darren, Pittsburgh won game one, 4-2. And at the end of that contest, Darian Hatcher was involved in some physical fray. This is just a carryover into game two as you check out the AMP Energy power play statistics. Look at the penalty killing for Pittsburgh, better than 90% on the playoff circuit.
And they've done that without Max Talbot, who's one of their prime penalty killers.
Returning to the lineup tonight for Pittsburgh, Jordan Staal will deflect this one back to neutral ice. Jones is good speed, getting help from Viron and Richards as the Flyers work 5-on-4. Richards plays a vacant wing. Gill on the poke check, didn't get it out. Jones will survey the situation. Danny Briere said he was happy with the first power play for the Flyers the other night. After that, they didn't move it oh so well. Philadelphia finished up 0-for-3 on the night.
There were only 5 power plays combined in the game. And really, neither power play amounted to much.
Briere really called himself out on the off day. Said, we have to be better. Beautiful moves. In! And Biron robs Dupuis, who may have shanked that shot. He did not appear to get all of it.
He probably surprised himself that the move worked.
Briere trying to do likewise. Orpik won't allow it. And the Penguins able to get it back to center.
What a great save, though. Marty Biron serving notice to his teammates. I'm ready for game two.
Staal from a weak angle. No worries there for Biron. Joffrey Lupul hurriedly back through center. As Fleury will slow it down. This one caroms right to the waiting Jordan Staal. And he'll send it the full length of the rink.
Becoming problematic, though, for the Flyers. They gave up a shorthanded goal in game one to Evgeny Malkin and a breakaway to Pascal Dupuis, killing penalty in game two.
Mike Richards is a very conscientious defensive player both ways, two-way guy, but you can try and take advantage of him when you go one-on-one. He's not used to backpedaling.
And he's used to having Kimmo Tiimonen as his partner back there on the power play. And that's a huge loss in those situations.
LaRocque wins the battle there with Smith and with Hatcher. Malkin is in that tussle as well. Penguins back to even strength. No score in this one, moving towards a 7-minute mark. Game two of the Eastern Conference Final on versus. Joffrey Lupul sends it right to Chris Letang, and he does not wait long to plop it back behind Biron's net as the fans here continue to salute the forechecking and the penalty killing. Darian Hatcher deliberately out of his own zone. This will be touched up by Letang. It's an icing call. No score in this contest between Atlantic Division rivals, but a great chance here. Dupuis, a near miss, shorthanded on Versus. Flyers and Penguins squaring off in game two of this Eastern Conference final. We knew that these two teams had a physical bent whenever they played each other during the regular season. And late in game one, there were some fireworks to break out.
And the guy in the middle of it was Upshaw. You see the face wash Malkin on Hatcher. But Upshaw, who got into the fight with Tyler Kennedy, was right in the middle of that. Took a 10-minute misconduct. And we knew it was going to be like this.
Scotty Upshaw got into a scrap with Mike Green in the opening round of these Eastern Conference playoffs. Mike Green and Washington. But that particular bout with Tyler Kennedy, many, many more big blows. Hartnell on the intercept, and that slapper went way high. Randy Jones keeps it in. Hartnell with a quick relay to the front. Briere was tiptoeing the crease. Back come the Penguins with Dupuis. Crosby marked along the boards by Kukkonen. Hartnell comes to support. If you're just jumping on board with us this Sunday night, the Flyers are down a defenseman as Braden Coburn was hit with a puck in the game's first 5 minutes and bloodied in need of attention. Down the alleyway comes Malkin to the front, and it caromed off the sliding defender there. Jones teaming up with the Kukkonen in back.
Brilliant desperation defensive move by Jones.
Crossbow snaps it right to the chest of Fleury. There's no rebound as we visit with Chris Simpson.
Well, Joe, just an update on Braden Coburn. I can tell you he is behind closed doors right now being stitched up. They're hopeful he might be able to return tonight, but really we don't know. We don't know the extent of the damage or exactly where those stitches, obviously in the face region, but not sure where on the face he's being stitched up. We'll hope to get more information to you soon. Joe?
Chris, we appreciate the update, and we think immediately of Stefan Robida on the back line for Dallas, who was hit in the face in the opening round series with Anaheim. Jarkko Ruutu engaging there with Darian Hatcher just a second or two ago. There's a penalty call coming against Philadelphia. Pittsburgh is going to go a man to the good right now. It'll be a tripping call.
John Stevens saw his defenseman Darian Hatcher flatten Jarkko Ruutu on one side. Carter on the other side.
Philadelphia penalty to 17, 2 minutes for tripping.
Whistled for tripping. Sticks out the left leg. That will get you every single time. Stall to the ice. Carter to the box. Ruutu took a big hit. Didn't want to leave Darian Hatcher's side, but nothing came of it.
Malone exchanging a swing of the stick with R.J. Umberger before the faceoff. The Amp Energy special teams numbers for Pittsburgh's power play and Philadelphia's shorthanded unit. The Flyers have surrendered a power play goal in 9 of their last 11 in the postseason, although they did blank Pittsburgh 2-for-2 the other night. Gotchar cranks it up wide. Biron was screened. Darian Hatcher has some time, and R.J. Umberger also has enough time to play it all the way down the deck.
That was one number the Pens weren't very happy with. They thought that they have to get on the job on the power play more often. If they get 5 or 6 opportunities, they figure they can really get their offense going.
Kapanen able to play it off the boards and back. And John Stevens talking to his Flyer penalty killers, discussing their left-handed power play unit.
First unit, all left-handed. Got to make sure the flow for the one-timers. Left to right, passing across the zone.
Sikora with Malkin. Malkin off of a 3-point performance in game one. Play catch with Crosby. Backdoor look. Kick out, saved by Biron. Was a gem as he robbed Ryan Whitney.
He said with Marty Biron that one of the differences playing the Pittsburgh Penguins, they don't always just shoot for the sake of shooting, so everything might be a quality scoring chance.
Tough for a goalie to find a groove in that situation. Umberger one-on-one against Gonchar. And Sergei plays into the boards. Back comes Pittsburgh in transition. It's Stahl. fires one off the defender as Hatcher took it away. 20 seconds left and the minor penalty to Jeff Carter. Malkin on the overload. Slapper that was weakened by Hatcher. Letang feeds it. Sikora bluffed it all the way through to Malkin, then gets it. Sharp angle off the outside of the post. Malkin to a better angle, denied by Biron, and then a quick whistle. There's a penalty call to come. We'll tell you about it after we visit with Bill at Hockey Central.
Philadelphia penalty, it's number 22, 2 minutes for cross-checking.
Bill, thank you. It did get a little nasty last night in Motown.
And it's getting nastier here. Mike Knuble with the cross-check to the small of the back of Jordan Staal. Knuble to the box. Jordan Staal won't have to go to the infirmary for that one.
I think I can read between the lines with your comment there. Martin Biron's team will face a lightning quick 5-on-3. Jeff Carter is already standing at the penalty box door. He's got 4 ticks left in his sentence. Richards lost control of the draw. 5-on-4 right now as Carter makes a break for it. Deflection, score! Crosby off Kukkonen. 1-0 Pittsburgh.
Only 4 seconds on the 5-on-3, and you can see top of your screen coming out of the box, but not in time from a puck possession standpoint. They win the faceoff. Deflected, short side, Lassi Kukkonen, the defender, tries to help his goaltender. Biron, thinking it's going one way, just leaves a space between the pad and the post. Crosby gets his 4th goal of the postseason, 2nd in this series. And maybe more importantly, Joe, the 1st goal of the hockey game yet again for the Pittsburgh Penguins.
Who have been oh so tough to take out inside of Mellon Arena, where they've won 6 straight to start the playoffs. Carter closing, looking to respond right back. It dribbled along the paint. Point position blast coming from Smith. And that hit a maze of traffic in front. A whistle as it was played with a high stick. We'll bring it back to you in just a few moments. Sidney Crosby on the board. Pittsburgh has the advantage. These are the Stanley Cup playoffs on Versant.
Penguins on top 1-0, courtesy of Sidney Crosby on a power play, but it started with him in a face-off win. 5-on-3 with only 4 seconds, but he's just going to make sure that he wins to his strong side, his forehand to the boards. They have the numbers. Mike Richards chases, but he can't be too aggressive. He's on the ball. They're able to now control the puck out of the pens, even though time expires. And then, on their AccuView Telestrator, it skips home off of Lassi Kukkonen.
Crosby's 4th in the playoffs from Gonchar on the power play at 10:48. Whistle offside against Pittsburgh. Gary Roberts matching up with Yaroslav Modry and friends. A veteran clash there. Sergei Gonchar, a man who quarterbacks so many different aspects of the Penguins with respect to a breakout, with respect to the way they work in the offensive zone. He has what they call that high hockey IQ.
Certainly does, often maligned because of his defensive, supposedly, inadequacies. He's not a physical defender, but I still say he's pretty darn good in his own zone. And on the offensive side of things, you're right. Thinks the game at a very high level.
Now the Flyers were talking about the man who pairs up with Gonchar, Orpik, for that physical atmosphere. Orpik threw a half dozen hits in game 1, and several of them were real heavy-duty ones.
And they're well matched along those lines.
Danny Briere's line is out there for Philadelphia, working with Vinny Prospel and Scott Hartnell. Hartnell likes to play along the boards as he chases after Orpik. Sikora steers it to center. Just over 8 minutes to go in the opening period, a 1-0 advantage for Pittsburgh. Game 2 of the Eastern Conference final on Versus. It's offside against Pittsburgh. And coming up tomorrow, Versus heads to Dallas. Game 3 of the Western Conference final. The Red Wings and Stars with that series Detroit in control, 2-0. 8 Eastern time tomorrow, 7 Central, right here on Versus, the national cable home of the Stanley Cup playoffs. Mike Emmerich, Eddie Olczyk, and Bob Harwood relocating to Dallas today. They'll have all the action for you.
That one should be more vitriolic as well after the way that game ended last night. Blood boiling on both sides in the conference final.
Letang crossing over to beat Knubel to it. Roberts will golf it in as these two teams play at even strength. Upshaw out of the penalty box after his encounter with Tyler Kennedy. Working on a wing with Carter. And Knubel up front for John Stevens. Jason Smith putting it along the boards and a bit strong. Gary Roberts will tumble it ahead. Roberts, who began these playoffs with a bang and a 2-goal game in that opener against Ottawa. Pittsburgh, for the most part, has breezed through the postseason.
He set the tone, didn't he, Gary Roberts, for this relatively, what you would consider, young group of core players?
Marian Hossa on a takeaway. Hossa turns the corner to the front, all the way to point position. There's Scuderi. Looking in Crosby's direction. Kukkonen latched onto him. Crosby swivels free. Scuderi, rink wide. Gill waiting for a screen to develop. Missed the target. Scuderi shovels it. Crosby, quick pass. Hossa blocked. Follow-up chance around Richards. Marian Hossa for Sidney Crosby. Gets it in gear. They got rattled by Richards. At a point position, it's Scuderi. Gill on this side. Long wrister squelched. Joffrey Lucal says go away.
Yeah, and get to the bench if you're a Philadelphia Flyers because you just spent the entire shift in your own zone chasing. And that's what Pittsburgh can do. They don't just put the puck blindly to the net. That's what Marty Biron was talking about. Every chance they usually get is a quality scoring chance.
Biron telling Hatcher this is icing, and the linesmen agree.
Biron said that's an adjustment for his defenseman, but as a team, they're going to have to adjust. The back line, this is what they're missing with Kimmo teaming it out with a blood clot in his ankle. Braden Coburn hit early in this game with a puck to the face. That's a lot of minutes. That's your top two defenders. They played in tandem. So Darian Hatcher and John Stevens, too, are going to have to pick up that extra slack.
Darren, just one other number to add to the point you were making about Biron and saying that Pittsburgh doesn't shoot it unnecessarily. The Penguins do not have a shot at even strength in this hockey game. All of their shots, the half dozen of them, have come with a manpower advantage. Oh, Rock'em Sock'em hit there. Marian Hatcher catching Ryan Malone, the Pittsburgh native.
Two quality crunches by Hatcher in this first period.
Carter didn't get it through. Sikora will dish it back out. Michel Therrien was saying about Pittsburgh, you know, our defense probably is not going to get enough credit. With all the offensive weapons they possess, that's the first thing everybody looks at. But this team has been buttoned up in its own zone. Flyers trying to crack through and equalize here. Dowd for Kapanen. Downey, point position. Blocked, good play there by Jarkko Ruutu. He intercepted Kukkonen's shot.
Steve Downey in the lineup tonight. Replacing Patrick Thorsson. A big body, heavy stick. A guy that John Stevens says plays better in big games. He's being given the opportunity.
Downey scratched the last three outings for Philadelphia. He's into the lineup. Patrick Thorsson is out tonight. Not given a jersey by John Stevens. Good send in. Hartnell upset there by Gonchar with one glove. He's denied by Marc-Andre Fleury. Philadelphia and Pittsburgh as the pleasantries continue around Fleury's crease. 1-0 for the Pens. The nearby Monongahela River in the steel city of Pittsburgh. On Versus. Pittsburgh has the lead in this Eastern Conference final. 1-0. They've got the lead in this game, too. 1-0, thanks to Sidney Crosby.
Face-off win. They were able to overload because they had the numbers. And speaking of numbers,
it's been an eventful year for Sidney.
Good and bad. He started out the hottest scorer in the league. He's doing quite well in the playoffs as well. Goals now in back-to-back games. They had the high ankle sprain, missed 28 games. And because of that, Evgeny Malkin challenged to be the leader, as we talked about in our open by Mike Therrien. Malkin the leader, but they're strong down the middle. Jordan Staal, the third line centerman. All young, all very, very good hockey players.
And on this Mother's Day, Sydney's mom, Trina, is in attendance at Mellon Arena. This is just the second Pittsburgh playoff game she's seen since her son has been in the big leagues. Dad's a regular in these parts.
They look at Jordan Staal, not really a score. Sidney Crosby, to me, I don't know that he's 100%. He doesn't seem to have the explosiveness, but having said that, he still is so willing to go into the high traffic areas and make plays. And I think that differentiates him from a lot of the other skill players. And Kenny Malkin, in Crosby's abs, that was part of the challenge put to him. Mike Terry said, I need you to be a leader. Malkin has come out there and given him a 1-2 punch offensively. Staal, more of a defensive center, if you will.
Therrien would say about Malkin, I need you to lead the right way. There's a penalty call coming here. Referee Dan O'Halloran spotting an infraction. And bringing Pascal Dupuis with him to the penalty box. Got them both. Jason Smith is also in the box for Philadelphia. Folks, you can win a trip for two to see a Stanley Cup final game. Text Stanley to Versus. That's 837-787. And you'll be entered in the I Am the Stanley Cup ticket sweepstakes. All right, Darren, let's see what we can decipher from this last scrum.
Two guys called for hooking. Dupuis, that was an obvious one. Jason Smith as well.
Smith gets the game for interference.
So he was interfering and resisting back was Dupuis. He got called for the hook.
Plenty of open ice out there, 4-on-4. Another sturdy hit delivered. Gonchar and Upshaw colliding. 4 minutes and change away from the Dodge intermission report. We're checking back in at Hockey Central. Between periods 1 and 2, Jeff Carter wrists one right to the gut of Fleury. It trickles away, and Marian Hossa strides back in concert with Crosby. Crosby working to the inside. Gonchar the trailer. Gonchar, no angle. Orpik, Hossa fires. It's knocked down. Rebound there for a moment. Jones didn't get it out and then lost his stick in the process. Hossa guns it again. That was knocked down. Crosby's pass played away by Carter. Sergei Gonchar keeping it on the outside. Crosby drops it in his wake. Hossa, as the 4-on-4 play continues. Goal line, Gonchar, stopped, trickles there. Crosby says it's in. Biron says it isn't. There's no red light, and the officials say no.
Was Sid the kid just trying to sell it? Take a look at it. Goal cam view. Oh my, puck up on Ed. We might have had some white ice between the puck.
You have to see daylight here.
There has to be white ice between the black puck and the red goal line. And because it was on its edge.
Ooh. How close can you get? Video goal judge here as Biron's webbing captures that. Is Jim Weaver at Mellon Arena.
Does the puck get sideways? I think that is as close as it gets.
The call on the ice was no goal. There was never a red goal light turned on behind Biron. The official, Dan O'Halloran, who's on the phone right now, he was right there. He never pointed. So you have to have conclusive video evidence to overturn it.
And what they'll be looking for is the white between the black and the red.
That one caromed up off the face of Darian Hatcher and almost dribbled to that line.
Well, this should be a real good look. See how it spiraling, sputtering? There it looks over there. But just looks.
All of this with 3:19 to go.
Is it conclusive?
In the opening period. Is that conclusive enough? With the help of the video goal judge here, Jim Weaver, and I am sure the review room in Toronto.
Or is that just circumstantial? I should have got my law degree. Joe, maybe I could figure that out a little
bit. Come on now, Ivy Leaguer, help us all out.
Ivy Leaguer, my Cornell Big Red. We were watching lacrosse last night before the game on Versus, the Dallas-Detroit game. They were upset by the Ohio State Buckeyes, and some upset people one way or the other, depending on how this one. That, to me, looks like it's going to be a goal.
You know what the trouble is? The glove of Biron obscures your view. You can't tell the puck and the goal line relationship.
Right.
Because of the glove.
It looked to me when it's spiraling there that there's a flash of white ice between the red line and the puck. But again, it has to be absolutely conclusive, as you said, because the original call on the ice was no goal.
This brings me back to last spring. Rangers Sabres, a goal you could assume was in against the pad of Henrik Lundqvist, but you could not show visually.
Well, that's the thing. I don't know. That to me looks visually like there might be a much better case than the one you're talking about.
So many of these situations, you wind up splitting hairs.
That's
and
right.
And it's so close to call.
And for all you folks watching at home, we're just trying to give you every single scenario that they're looking at. It's the glove. It has to be definitive.
It was a 4-on-4 situation. Sidney Crosby and the Penguins really were dominating that shift.
And have many, many shifts in this first period. Skating 4-on-4, it looked more like a power play. Not special teams per se, but specialty play skating 4-on-4. Sidney Crosby, Marian Hossa, Sergei Gonchar in concert, the three of them just owning the puck. It gets to this point, it's on edge. And I'm right there.
Is that enough?
See, that to me, that
is
the look that shows you the edge of the puck, and there's white right there.
Once Biron's glove comes into the party, you can't see the goal line anymore, and you can't say anything. So close.
Yeah, that's frame by frame.
This review now upwards of 4 minutes.
And you can see why. You know, you cannot be hasty. And he's showing, look at Sidney Crosby, it was on its edge. And
he was right there, and he reacted instantly with the raise of the arm, and of course he would.
And of course, Biron, he said, I got it. Both guys trying to sell their particular point of the argument.
Referee O'Halloran was very, very close by. Sergei Gonchar, who assisted on Crosby's first marker tonight.
He was very, very good on that shift.
Modri chit-chatting with Biron, and still no decision.
And it's one of those situations, technology, the advent of it. You look at owner and former great here, Mario Lemieux. You think of the eye-hand coordination. Watch Sidney Crosby's reaction. And then he's explaining. It's on its side. He sees the white ice, he thinks, between the puck and the goal line. And they are such special athletes. Partly he's a scorer, and he would think of it that way. But on the other side, their vision, especially Sidney Crosby's, you'd have to say that was as good as any video replay could be.
And you could tell from that last angle, referee O'Halloran was, 2 feet behind
right.
Crosby. So he also had a very good look and never gave it the referee's point that that's in. So you have to have conclusive evidence to overturn this no-goal call.
I know where Marty Biron is hoping.
Game number 2 of the Eastern Conference Final. Pittsburgh leads 1-0. Do they have a 2-0 advantage? No.
There you go. Because, and I think it's exactly what you said, Joe. The fans here don't like it, but when they take that long, it has to be conclusive evidence. And it was very, very circumspect, certainly circumstantial.
And we will continue. 4-on-4 for the next 51 seconds. Martin Biron talking about this old barn yesterday. He says it can give a goalie fits, get some funny bounces out there, some creaky boards. He got his goalie stick tied up in the boards in game 1.
First NHL start for him here. Gave up 4 goals in the first period. So he's had some heebie-jeebies in this building from the moment he set foot in the National Hockey League.
With a 4-on-4 play, this was dumped in from behind the center line. So it's an icing call against Pittsburgh.
not thrilled because he's getting word, as is Sidney Crosby, he's getting word from his coach. But a lot of times the coaching staff, they're watching what you're watching at home. And they're saying, it looks like it might be good. They're talking about it might be good, but it has to be conclusive because as we were saying, it has to be definitive. And I think it makes a very strong case that with the glove the way it was, could you ever see enough with certainty that puck in its entirety across the goal line?
Sidney Crosby, who did not score in round two against the Rangers, has two goals in this Eastern Conference final against Philadelphia, including the one that counts tonight. A 1-0 lead for Pittsburgh as we approach the Dodge intermission report. The Stanley Cup final is continuing exclusively on Versus and available to you in high definition. Malone shoulder to shoulder with Richard. At a point position, Ryan Whitney sends it south of the goal line. There's Hatcher, forced back by Malkin. As the teams go 5-on-5 now, Richards finessed his way to center and dumps it in. Dupuis, the bump set for Hossa. On for Crosby, who has an edge. Blocked down by Modrý. Crosby to point position. Ryan Whitney on the way, turned aside by Biron. And then Biron wants to get his guys a breather. He'll cover up.
And as you speculated, Joe, the official word from Toronto, they couldn't get a singular definitive shot of white ice between the puck that Sidney Crosby had tried to stuff at the post behind Marty Biron. And as we surmised, with the on-ice call being no goal, it stood as no goal.
That's what's so tough. You can assume it's under that glove and in, but you can't show it. And if you can't, then you can't call it that way. That's the way it works.
Exactly.
Fans will hate it. Pittsburgh.
Well, they can't overturn the call. Because let's think, there was a call made.
Yes.
The call was no goal. And they couldn't overturn it, and they didn't.
Dupuis, a penalty call coming up against Philadelphia. As Knuble makes a touch-up, Pittsburgh goes a man to the good once more. Scotty Upshaw has been a regular visitor to the penalty box tonight.
This won't make John Stevens, the coach, very happy. But again, Scotty Upshaw and his mates spending an inordinate amount of time in their own zone. And when you chase, you end up reaching like this with the left arm. It's not much, but it's enough. And especially on Sidney Crosby, who's fighting, keeping his feet moving. Upshaw doesn't like the call, but he's got to keep his feet moving.
Richards, Kukkonen, Dowd, and Hatcher protecting Biron on the penalty kill for Philadelphia. Pittsburgh in the black, working 5-on-4. Malkin broke his hockey stick in half on that slapper. Malone measured by Kukkonen. 70 seconds to go in the opening period. Malkin playing the two-man game with Crosby. Switch the point of attack for Gonchar, rejected by Kukkonen. That hit him in the hand. Flyers already without Braden Coburn, who was injured in the first 5 minutes of the game tonight. Took a puck in the face. Malkin for Crosby. 45 seconds with which to work. Gonchar, high-scoring power play point producer. Malkin, eyed there by Richards. The pass, that hit Malkin's old stick, and Karam's back to center. Gonchar strolling in, beautiful look. Crosby, one more! As it was knocked down in front. Good defense there by Kukkonen and Knuble. Malkin digging for it. Malone on top Gonchar. 15 seconds in the period. Get Malkin's stick out of the way.
Kukkonen is now without his hockey stick.
Gonchar off of his back foot, pumped it wide. 5 seconds in the period. And the Flyer penalty killers survive.
Well put. Survived the period through the Flyers.
20 minutes complete in Pittsburgh. And after one-third of regulation, the Penguins, thanks to a strike from Sidney Crosby on the power play at 10:48, have the lead over Martin Biron and the Flyers. The Dodge intermission report is coming up. After this break, we'll send you to Bill Patrick, Keith Jones, and Ryan Engblom on Versus.
The Stanley Cup playoffs on Versus are brought to you by Dodge, introducing the all-new Dodge Journey. If you can dream it, do it. Dodge. Grab life.
the Eastern Conference Final, Game 2 continuing exclusively on Versus here inside of Mellon Arena. Pittsburgh trying to win 10 of its first 11 in the postseason. Last team to do that, 95 Red Wings. Joe Beninati, Darren Elliott with you. Pittsburgh knows if they get contributions from Sidney Crosby, they're in good shape. They got more from him in the first.
They really did, and Sidney Crosby had one goal. 5-on-3, it started. Finds the back of the net off of Lasse Kukkonen. Almost made it 2-0. Long review, inconclusive. The call at the time was no goal, and it stood up because they couldn't find the conclusive evidence. Sidney Crosby thought he had two goals. Pittsburgh Penguins, though, a pretty dominant first period in certain situations, but if you're the Philadelphia Flyers, you have to like the fact that at even strength, you outshot the Pittsburgh Penguins 9-1.
Malkin finds himself on top of the Stanley Cup playoff scoring heap. As we begin period two, tail end of a Pittsburgh power play with Scotty Upshaw in the box for another 20 seconds. Mike Knuble will make a break for it. Pickpocketed there by the back-checking Marian Hossa.
He's a madman when it comes to coming back with the stick lift. Best I've ever seen at it.
Crosby knifing in. Chips it for Malkin. There's Hossa. Fine stop for Biron, and he'll cover up.
Great reaction by Marian Hossa. He keeps getting great feeds from Crosby and thinks he should be scoring more. This one was Malkin to Hossa. Biron, brilliant. Hossa looks to the heavens.
Marian Hossa and Martin Biron, they'll run into each other a time or two over the next few days in this playoff round. All of us at Versus want to welcome the men and women in uniform watching around the world on AFN, the American Forces Network. We appreciate your bravery and hope you have time to speak with Mom today. This Mother's Day evening in Pittsburgh, as we settle in for more in Game 2 of the Eastern Conference Final. Joe Beninati, Darren Elliott, Chris Simpson with you tonight, enjoying Flyers and Penguins Part 2. Modrý keeps it on the outside as the Flyers work back to neutral, and hovering there in good defensive posture was Peter Sikora. Umberger and Richards on ice. Hartnell out there as well. Flyers are in the midst of a change. Counterpunch, Sikora shrugged away by Biron. 1-0 for Pittsburgh. Darren, Sidney Crosby as the game's only marker.
That was just another example. So quick in transition are the Pittsburgh Penguins.
Philadelphia here, offside on the rush. This Flyers team has lost game one in each of its first two rounds, Darren, but then they've got the mojo to bounce back.
They certainly have. Look at what they've done. After losing game one against Washington, came back 2-0. Montreal 4-2. That Montreal, 9 different players with a point. That really shows you that everybody came back to the fore. For the Flyers, they're going to do it 3 times in succession.
Including the regular season, the Flyers have lost their last 4 on this ice sheet. Briere dodging the hit of Orpik. Gonchar takes over and plays it down the dasher. It'll come all the way on the freshly cut ice sheet. It'll be an icing call against Pittsburgh. It's behind the play. Hartnell gets into it with Gonchar.
Hartnell, he was one of those guys that said, you know what, if they think it was their magic, look at him chirping. He was, I don't think so. We gave them that game. And he's, those are biting words. He plays with an edge, acerbic tongue, and he's going to back up that statement.
John Stevens, the head coach, as Jones fires, it's deflected down. Briere was at the post. John Stevens said his guys were too stretched out throughout the night. They did not support each other well in that, quote, five-man unit.
Yeah, that's what Brian Englund was talking about.
2-on-1, closing in. Crosby, well played. Follow-up chance, and Biron was ready. Jason Smith sprawled defensively to make that defensive play. Marian Hossa locked up along the boards by Hatcher.
It's going to be a penalty here. It looks like it's going to be on Pittsburgh.
Moving in, Prospel, backhander, knocked down by Fleury. Rebound trickles to the corner. Biron's on the bench. 6 attackers on for Philadelphia. Closing in, Richards waits for Dupuis to slide by. Kukkonen fires! And a pad save for Fleury.
Brilliant puck possession movement by Richards. Nice left pad by Fleury. This one's heating up. Hartnell stirred the ire. I think it's going to be an errant stick lift. Hossa called for holding right there. Left hand on the board. Stays with it just a little too long. Didn't have good body position. And just battling in front, Hartnell, Briere, and a nice job by Fleury to come out of that traffic and find the puck.
During the regular season, only Montreal had more power play goals than Philadelphia. Flyers skating 5-on-4 right now, trying to tie this tally up at 1. Hal Gill spins it back onto the Flyers' side of the rink.
Trying to find a way to be productive without Kimmo Tiiminen to quarterback that power play from the blue line. But Philadelphia, Jonesy was talking about, they've done a good job at even strength, being physical. A 9-1 shot advantage in that first at even strength shows that they're doing some things much better skating 5-on-5. The key is to make sure you're at least skating 5-on-5 and then make it count when you get to power plays of your own like they are on right now.
Jeff Carter drops it for Joffrey Lupul. On top for Modrý. Modrý waits. Top of the umbrella. Richards creeping in from his point position. Richards tied up by Malone, challenged by Gill, got it back for Modrý again. One-timer whistled wide by Joffrey Lupul. Richards, who led the Flyers in points during the regular season, great look. Traffic in front, Lupul didn't get it through, and the Flyers will have to retreat and fetch. Early in this game, Darren, Braden Colburn was hit in the face. Ooh, strange dump in Karam there. Put back out to center, so Colburn is out. You mentioned the loss of Tiiminen. The Flyers are missing an awful lot on that back end.
They
right
are,
now.
And it even comes to on this power play. They've been using Randy Jones. Modrý was used there with Mike Richards. With only 5 defensemen, you've got to use different guys in different situations to give them the appropriate rest.
Maxime Talbot into the lineup. Had that broken foot he sustained in Game 3 of the series against the Rangers. Wearing protective equipment on both skates tonight. As Briere pitches it off the end wall. Crosspull finding Briere. Danny Briere scans the defense. Crosspull is next. Little give and go to the crease. Never got through. Lassi Kukkonen finding Crosspull. John Stevens wants him to move his feet off the wall tonight. Can't be an easy guy to check. Orpik with a strip. There's another penalty call. It appears to be interference. Referees tonight, Kelly Sutherland and Dan O'Halloran.
Great react by Coach Mike Terry.
Pittsburgh penalty to number 9. 2 minutes for interference.
There it is. Kukkonen diving down from his point position, falling down after the push, the nudge by Pascal Dupuis. Of course, Kukkonen never had the puck, thus interference.
This Flyer power play group blanked in 3 of its last 4 outings overall. This is Game 2 of the Eastern Conference Final, available to you in high definition on Versus. Pittsburgh leading the series 1-0. Evgeny Malkin had a huge hand in that victory back on Friday. Right now, the Penguins are shorthanded for the 3rd time in the evening. Pittsburgh wins the draw. And it will be Jordan Staal to guide it all the way down. Staal won a game-high 11 faceoffs in the first game. He was 5-1 in the first period tonight.
Excellent job in that faceoff circle. Pittsburgh, very good. And he should be the dominant team on home ice because the opposition has to, they have to give their positioning first.
Carter feeds it. Richards guides it for RJ Umberger. Umberger, wrister, knocked down. Umberger, who scored in each of the 5 games against Montreal, was held off the board here in his hometown in Game 1. The helmetless Joffrey Lupul to the front, score! Jeff Carter ties it at 1.
There are some Flyer fans here in attendance, cheering on Jeff Carter. Lupo with a quick spin. Hal Gill can't get the stick in lane.
Our Radio Shack goal cam shows you the puck flying by Fleury. Rob Scuderi unable to pick it up. Carter does, benches up, and we're all tied. Carter had a very good first period. Four shots on goal. That one counts here in the second.
Really good regular season, a career best 29 markers. That's his fifth in the postseason. Flyers looking for more. Hartnell with a wrister that's knocked down by Brooks Orpik. Jason Smith not there in time to keep it in. Hossa and Crosby 2-on-2. Crosby goes 360. That around the world pass picked off by Hartnell.
Hartnell back checking to the top of the crease. Helping out the defense.
Crossbow with a trigger right to the glove of Marc-Andre Fleury as we head to commercial break. The Flyers bouncing back. The power play goal for Carter. 1-1 here in Pittsburgh on Versus.
We have a tie game here at Mellon Arena in Pittsburgh. Well, the 1984 NHL draft was a pretty special one. Of course, Mario Lemieux picked over one, number one overall. Our Eddie Olczyk was number three. Look down at number 69, and you will find Atlanta Braves pitcher Tom Glavine. Yes, it's the same Tom Glavine who's with me now enjoying the game. Tom, the baseball thing worked out pretty well for you, but do you ever wonder what if you'd chosen hockey over baseball?
Well, of course I do. I mean, you come, you watch the game, you wonder what would have happened, and looking at that draft and knowing that I was drafted ahead of Brett Hull and Luke Robitaille, I know that obviously I would have been a Hall of Fame hockey player because those two guys are, so naturally I would have been.
It's obvious. What was the scouting report on you? Were you a good goal scorer?
I was a finesse player, goal scorer, yeah. I tried to stay out of the corners as much as I could and just let everybody pass me the puck and let me score goals and get all the glory.
Well, of course, baseball is your love now, but you've got three boys, you're telling me, and they're hockey players.
Yeah, they're all hockey players. They're home watching the game right now, so back in Atlanta, so I got to say hi to my boys. But, yeah, I think they're like their dad. Their first love is hockey, but they enjoy baseball as well.
What do you think of the talent on the ice tonight, Malkin and Crosby?
You know what? There's some good young players in NHL right now, and it's a shame this game doesn't get it the due that it deserves because it's a great game to come and watch. And, you know, for me, it's my favorite game to go to live, but unfortunately, I think so many people just don't understand it. But, yeah, there's a ton of young, great players in this game like Sidney and Malkin, and they're fun to watch.
I got to wonder, the same week you were drafted into the NHL was the same week you were drafted into Major League Baseball. How tough of a decision was it?
It was hard, but I think, you know, when you kind of go down the two sports and try and make a list of what's good and what's bad about both, I think the glaring difference for me was being a left-handed pitcher, I had a big advantage in baseball that I didn't necessarily possess in hockey. Nice save right there. But I just knew being a left-handed pitcher, that was something I had to take advantage of.
Well, you're not bad at play-by-play either. Thanks, Tom, for your time.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Joe and Darren, back to you.
Great call there by the southpaw. Nice. Gary Roberts catching his breath. 1-1. And let's go back to that 1984 draft list. And when you think about it, you got 600-plus goal scorers on that list, and our own Eddie Olczyk.
Eddie Olczyk's there. How about Troy Crosby on that list? Sidney Crosby's dad. He was a goaltender himself. He was actually Mario Lemieux's goaltender in junior. 6 degrees of separation in the building tonight. Closing in on all of us.
Tom Glavine's Braves rained out today in Pittsburgh. A rainy Mother's Day Sunday. We are indeed at 66 Lemieux Place, Mellon Arena's address. The Lemieux family looking on, watching this game two of the Eastern Conference Final. Deadlocked at one apiece. Sidney Crosby on the board for Pittsburgh. Jeff Carter here on the power play in period two. Spiron dangerously out of his own goal. Managed to get it back to center. Ryan Whitney trapped four of his buddies offside. And the fans put up a protest after they heard the whistle from the linesman, Brad Lazarowicz.
Follow up on Tom Glavine. Great stuff with Christine. He's in Atlanta. His boys are playing. I've had them in some of our clinics down in Atlanta. And Tom Glavine's actually a volunteer coach.
Really?
During the winter, yeah. Seen him on the ice. Loves the sport. Still participates as a youth hockey coach. Take a look at him on his BlackBerry like all everybody else in the world these days.
There are other players from the Braves and the Pirates all in attendance tonight. Pittsburgh doing so well. Hockey has obviously taken this city by storm. Sidney Crosby worked over by Jason Smith. Centering pass all the way back to Ryan Whitney. We go 5-on-5 here. Crosby knocked down by Smith. Counterattack, it's Sammy Kapanen. On the wing for Steve Downey. Downey pulls the trigger. That was blocked by Ryan Whitney. Just think about how good of an athlete the Massachusetts native Glavin is. As Richards rewinds, think about Dave Winfield, drafted in three different sports. Lucal snaps it right to the gut. Marc-Andre Fleury with a stop. And the guys gather around at the top of the crease again.
Billerica high for Tom Glavin play. But he brings up an excellent point, though, with the young talent. And when there's certain indicators that the NHL, not that it ever went anywhere, is on the rise again in terms of popularity. Popularity with other athletes. Because it's one of those sports that is drawn. Other athletes, golfers, are drawn to football players here, football coaches here in Pittsburgh. Because it is one of those ultimate team sports. And whether you played it or not, like Tom Glavin, you'll love it if you're from another discipline. And it just seems to be a groundswell again of other athletes from other pro sports paying attention to the National Hockey League.
And that'll carry over to, I'm sure, with other big leaguers once this series switches to Philadelphia for Game 3 at Wachovia Center. That'll be Tuesday night. We've got you covered on Versus for that one. Darian Hatcher on the reverse. Randy Jones plays the wing on through. R.J. Umberger and back at center. Scuderi giving some ground. Moving toward the midway mark of regulation. Gill didn't get a lot on that dumping. Jones carving away from pressure. Randy Jones now full blast. On the wing. Hartnell drive answered by Gill, who's getting better and better as this playoff season goes along. Jones behind the back. He was nearly clobbered there by Jarkko Ruutu.
That was a back pass of self-preservation.
He had him lined up. Smith outracing Sikora. Icing call. Here's Bill Patrick at Hockey Central. Bill, thanks for piquing the interest in that story that'll come towards the tail end of our Verizon Wireless intermission report before we start the third. Upshaw with a wrister, and it's snatched out of the air by Fleury. Scotty Upshaw, who's been in the penalty box a lot tonight, trying to beat Fleury and give the Flyers an advantage. Philadelphia had the lead in game 1-2-1, Darren, and then Pittsburgh roared home with 3 unanswered.
Carter with the goal here.
As we send you to ringside, we hear more from Chris Simpson on Braden Coburn.
Thanks, Joe. Yeah, just a bit of an update with that facial injury he suffered earlier in this game. Bad news for the Flyers. He will not return this evening. No word on future games in this series, but we know one thing for sure tonight. He will not be back on the ice, Joe.
All righty, Chris. Bad news for Philadelphia indeed.
And one of the reasons why Tom Glavin chose baseball.
Yeah, that was a deflected puck in the first period. The slap shot from the point and ramped up off of Peter Sikora's stick. And while Colburn was engaged with Evgeny Malkin, yes, he practically couldn't see it. They clipped him square in the face, and down he went in heat. Malkin dangling away from Umberger. Sikora winds and fires. Glove save, Biron. He'll hold. We'll hang out. Back to Pittsburgh in a moment. One-one here in Pittsburgh. They're sold out again inside of Mellon Arena. Here's your Dodge storyline. It began with an unfortunate bang for the Flyers.
Will not return, and then power play goal by Sidney Crosby. Answered back, power play goal in this period by Jeff Carter. We're all square at one.
There are the two marksmen. The guys at Hockey Central, Ryan Ekblom in particular thought Crosby may have been looking for a centering pass on his goal, trying to feed Malone.
It went off cooking and stick. But again, the ability to control the puck on the 5-on-3 faceoff, which was only 4 seconds, allowed them to make that play to the front of the net. Throw it to the net, you never know what might happen.
9:20 to go in the middle stanza. Hartnell putting some heat on Sergei Gonchuk.
Putting some heart and soul into this second period is Scott Hartnell backing up his biting words. If they think it was their magic that led to that victory, they got another thing coming. We gave it to them.
Larocque playing from corner to corner. Maxime Talbot is there. Larocque posted up against Smith. Hartnell lifting the blade of Larocque. Biron helping his own cause. And Danny Briere, who in his own right wanted to be much better tonight. Flyers to a man thought that they could all improve on their game one performance.
As Jeff Carter said, we got out of our systems. And so, you know, we got out of that. It gave them so many goals. 4 times they scored, the Pittsburgh Penguins, when the Flyers had full possession of the puck in game one. They've been so much better 5-on-5. It's really starting to show here, especially in this second period.
Loople, who picked up an assist on the second period goal from Carter. Watching now as the Penguins work in the attack territory. Gill has all day to shoot, and it's juggled and gloved by Martin Biron. Friends, next weekend, the NHL on NBC brings you 2 exciting Game 5 matchups, if they're necessary. First, Saturday, 1:30 Eastern, it's the Stars and the Red Wings in Hockey Town. Then Sunday at 3 Eastern time, it'll be Game 5 from back here at Mellon Arena. The Flyers and the Penguins, if necessary. The NHL on NBC next weekend.
Marty Biron with the save. Only his 3rd save and shot. He's had to contend with 5-on-5 from the Pittsburgh Penguins. 16-3 right now. 5-on-5 shots favoring Philadelphia.
Darren, as a former NHL goaltender in your own right, how difficult is that to get into your rhythm? Biron says they don't give me a chance to touch the puck very often.
I would always rather take my chances. You know, we're only firing that many shots. You just have to stay in it mentally, and he's a veteran. He should be able to do it. He looks like he's made the adjustment in this game thus far. But if you're in Philadelphia, you have to like the fact that you're really closing the gap better than you did. Playing together as 5-man units.
Crosby's feed, rink wide for Whitney. Whitney to the front, deflection try, and Biron stayed focused there. He made a good stop on Dupuis.
Right behind you.
Communication, you could hear at ice level. Hatcher drops for Jones. On the delay, Richards launched it to center. Knocked down by Ryan Malone. He'll play catch with Crosby. The deep slot beats Sikora, and Biron deep in his crease, able to stand tall. Loople scooped it, didn't get it clear. Sikora and the Pens, another chance to operate in that 3-quarter game John Stevens is so fearful of.
Yes, they weren't very good in game one, Philadelphia, getting the puck all the way deep. We've only had a couple of times where they've turned it over, but so quick are the Pens in transition. If you only let them have to go 3 quarters of the sheeted ice.
Letang looking for Malkin, a glance to side. It'll be Jones to twist it on back. Both teams in the midst of personnel changes. Skating 5-on-5, we close up on Ryan Whitney. Malkin manhandled there, too much so. Darian Hatcher slowed him down, and he's going to get the gate. Fleury making a mad dash to the bench as the whistle comes from referee O'Halloran. He says hooking.
Fans love it. Hatcher hates it. For most of his career, this was man-up defense. And for most of that play, it looked like man-up defense.
That is one tough call. You're going to try and stop Evgeny Malkin. You got to let the defenders do something.
And you can see the stick position once Malkin turned. It looked like it was draped around him, but that was not a hook. That was just a continuation of the man-up defense that Hatcher was playing. Tough call. Tough situation. Pittsburgh on the power play.
Gonchar fires. Stop. Rebound. Score! Marian Hossa
And the fans love it. And I said, Darian Hatcher hates it even more.
Face-off win, Joe. Bounce batted. And Hossa comes up with a loose puck, comes off the goal line, gets to that loose puck. Volkev, look at it. Biron can't squeeze it. Hossa with a quick stick. Puts this place into a frenzy.
On a Mother's Day night in Pittsburgh, Marian Hossa drinking it all in and giving Pittsburgh the advantage. The power play goal requiring just 9 seconds of power play time. All the goals in this contest on special teams, all on the power play. Stall engaged there by Modry. Turnover, Kennedy fires, stopped there. Biron stepped out on the angle well. Hartnell in tight quarters with Crosby. The retrieval made there by Orpik.
How frustrating that must be for Philadelphia to be so good 5-on-5, but to give up the two power play goals in this one.
Fans wanting a call. Hartnell has some room. Kicked out of there by Fleury. Pittsburgh defender was interfered with on that rush. In the eyes of the 17,000 or so paying referees. Tyler Kennedy waits for it. 2-1 for Pittsburgh. Kennedy got into an enthusiastic bout with Scotty Upshaw in the first. He has seen his mates take the lead here in the second. Marian Hossa, the trade day acquisition, gives him the advantage.
Score 2-1, Pittsburgh on top, power play goal. Malkin on Hatcher led to the power play chance. We're going to show you why it was called correctly. You stop it right there. Stick between the legs. Roll it. He does not disengage that stick between the legs. Referee gave him a chance. He didn't do it. It's got to be called hooking. Our AccuView telecharger shows you the reason for the call. Hatcher didn't get the stick out from between the legs of Evgeny Malkin. Officials correctly called it hooking because you can't call it the can opener. That's what they call it at ice level.
At first blush, it didn't seem to be much. But by the letter of the law, you're not allowed to do that. The officials make the call, send Hatcher away. 9 seconds later, Pittsburgh celebrates. It's 2-1, and this is an icing call against the visitors from the city of brotherly love. Malkin so far tonight, relatively quiet compared to the pyrotechnics he put up in game one. All the talk in the last 24 hours, or at least a great deal of it, has been about the gigantic scoring prowess of number 71 for Pittsburgh. Richards feeds, deflected, Fleury sprawls to cover. Mike Richards, who tallied twice in game one, was close to another one there for himself.
In on the forecheck, guy we featured in our open, Mike Richards, always put the puck to the net, Joe. You say that at this level, it works at every level for all you kids out there. Letang trying to block the passing lane, he forces his goaltender to come up with an acrobatic save. All because of the hard work of Mike Richards. Fleury, sharp there.
Mike Richards, so very well-rounded, Flyer MVP during the regular season. Better than 21 minutes a game in the postseason. That's tops for all Flyer forwards.
They compare him to Bobby Clark, longtime captain of the Philadelphia Flyers. And in our open, I said, maybe the most complete two-way forward of his generation. His generation certainly being under the age of 25, if you want a more specific definition.
Slapper coming from point position. Sizzled wide of Marc-Andre Fleury. 4.5 minutes away from a Verizon Wireless intermission report. Plenty to do for the guys at Hockey Central between periods 2 and 3, and a special interview coming up this Mother's Day with Chris Simpson, all that between periods two and three. As we continue exclusive coverage of the Eastern Conference Final on Versus. Lupul with a snapshot that went wide. Crosby hooks the outlet pass. On for 6'7" Hal Gill. As Hatcher stepped up on him. He watched Dupuy go in there like a buzzsaw on the forecheck. Jeff Carter, who has the goal for Philadelphia tonight. There was a power play strike here in period two. Set up very well by Joffrey Lupul. Knubel put down to his wallet. Upstall shimmies along that goal line. Orpik takes care of him. Sergei Gonchar with his head up. He'll create the breakout. Gonchar gliding to dump it in. All the way to Malkin. Who just happens to be Sergei Gonchar's tenant. Malkin living at the Gonchar Ranch.
That's been a long-standing policy here. Young players live with either families. Marilyn, you did it. Craig Simpson did it. And right now, Lemieux is the landlord, with Sidney Crosby still a tenant.
Flyers just changing personnel. Ooh, Danny Briere got hit up high. Referees allowing the play to continue. 2:55 to go, second period. And skating 5-on-5. This is Evgeny Malkin. As Richards bears down on him. Jones occupied there with Sikora at center. As the bodies are starting to fly.
Downey on Malkin, and immediately Brooks Orpik came and wondered if he wanted to do more than that.
Darian Hatcher away from two Penguins on the wing. Lupul sifting it back behind Fleury. In the middle of that trapezoid, he got hit. It squirts back to center. There's Yaroslav Modry. He'll see an awful lot of ice time tonight. Braden Coburn will not return for the Flyers. He was struck by the puck in the first period in the face. He's being stitched up. Flyers tell us that he will not be back in this game, too. Kennedy twists it for Jordan Staal. Staal working below the goal line. Hatcher trades him off to Richards. There's another penalty call coming. It'll be against the Flyers with 1:45 now to go in period two. There's a touch-up as Hartnell gets into it with Scuderi at center. Philly goes shorthanded.
It's heating up, and it's been going on for a couple of shifts now.
Just a few moments ago, we mentioned that Danny Briere got clipped up high.
Forearm shift right there. Oh, you look left if you're Malkin, but you hit right. Briere, wobbly, woozy from that point forward. Had a hard time getting over the boards under his own power. Moments ago, Hatcher on the backside of Staal. Daniel Briere still in some discomfort at the very least, because of that forearm shift delivered by Evgeny Malkin.
Briere sustained a knee injury in this building during the regular season, a collision with Jarkko Ruutu. This Philadelphia team that has been so resilient, and they have to work on the shorthanded situation again as the big alternate captain stands and now sits inside the penalty box. Scott Hartnell and Jarkko Ruutu are at each other's nose to nose.
Kind of draw there. And a good no call. Hatcher, unfortunately, since again we showed you that he was correctly called on his last one. Doesn't like the fact that he's whistled for cross-checking this time.
Both of those guys, as you can see, Ruutu and Hartnell, who preceded him down the dressing room tunnel for the Flyers. As Richards digs in against Sidney Crosby, the man with whom he was World Junior teammates with. Malone back to point position for Gonchar. Richards forcing Gonchar back to center with 90 ticks left in this middle frame. Malkin trying to enhance Pittsburgh's lead. They have the lead in this series, one game to none. It'll swing to Wachovia Center in Philadelphia for game three on Tuesday night. Biron taking no chances. He'll melt that and hear the whistle.
Why would he take a chance at the side of the net? Oh, so close in the first period to having one called a goal. Inconclusive was the evidence. That went his way. Right now, Pittsburgh having their way against John Stevens' gang. Two power play goals, a difference.
John Stevens, a very analytical head coach, and not afraid to share his insights with members of the media. We've been meeting with John day to day and learning a lot about this Flyer attack. We know he likes Jeff Carter a whole bunch, as it's gloved there by Fleury. And after each whistle right about now, Darren, there is pushing, there is shoving, there's a lot of verbal sparring going on.
Well, he has to like the fact that against Crosby's Penguins, John Stevens' gang, that was our worst game of the playoffs. They've come back with a fine effort here through 40 minutes. He said, you know what, though, if you have kids, you'll understand this one. He said, you don't have a kid come home and score, their test score is really bad, but they only made one mistake, but they repeated it throughout. He goes, we only have to correct one thing from game one, and it was the ability to hang on to the puck, manage the puck. They've done that much better, taking care of their turnovers. He says, you correct one thing, all of a sudden your test score goes way up. Well, so far, they're testing out quite well, especially 5-on-5.
Gonchar blazes it right to the chest of Biron. 40 seconds to go in period number two. Pittsburgh, the lead tally provided on the power play by Marian Hossa. The Penguins will have the man advantage for the balance of this period. Richards with a steal. He'll waltz in solo. Richards fires. He scores! Another shorthanded goal for Mike Richards.
How about another monumental goal for Mike Richards? 23 seconds remaining, shorthanded, down in the game, down in the series. And the two guys we featured, the top of our show, figure prominently, Malkin with the turnover, Richards with Pater.
So opportunistic on the business end of that breakaway. He was among the NHL leaders in shorthanded goals during the regular season. He had a huge shorthanded goal in that series win over Montreal. He gets the twine there.
And in the process, ties the game and silences this crowd, which was rather raucous.
Unassisted and shorthanded at 19:36. 10 seconds now to go in this middle frame. Randy Jones puts it off of Richards' wallet. Mike Richards will scoop it high. Almost got that center ice scoreboard as we come to the conclusion of period two. Marian Hossa with a power play goal, Mike Richards with a shorty, and after 40 minutes, it's two apiece. The Verizon Wireless Intermission Report is coming up after the break. Bill Patrick, Keith Jones, and Brian Engblom. They'll keep you company at Hockey Central.
The Stanley Cup playoffs on Versus are brought to you by Bud Light. Endless refreshment from start to finish. Bud Light keeps it coming.
In game two, it's 2-2 after two. And in households all across the world today, families are sharing heartwarming stories with mom. And we've learned of an inspirational and emotional one in Pittsburgh. 18-year-old John Chalice of Freedom, PA. Earlier tonight, he visited with the Mario Lemieux, the Penguins great. John's been battling cancer for 2 years now. His condition is terminal. John, his mom Regina, his dad Scott, sister Alexis, they've had a lot of visitors tonight wishing them well. Steelers chairman Dan Rooney there. Troy Crosby, Sidney's dad. Ben Roethlisberger, the quarterback for the Steelers. John Smoltz, the Atlanta Braves outstanding pitcher. John has a story that has impacted so many kids and adults in this area. His courage, his attitude, just tremendous. And right now he's standing by with Chris Simpson.
Thanks very much, Joe. John, I'm here with John Chalice and his family. Hey, John, you're the envy of everyone in this arena right now. Tell me, what was it like hanging with those guys up in Mario's private bar?
Well, it was like all the kings of the city were up there. I mean, and just to hang out and be part of that, they treated me just like anybody else. And just to hang with them guys and be with them, I felt honored.
Well, I heard Ben say, too, he's going to see you at practice this week. Ben Roethlisberger invited you to Steelers practice.
Well, Big Ben, he said he was going to try to make that happen, and I believe I'll get to Steelers practice sometime later this week.
Well, John, your story has been an inspiration to so many people. If there was one message you wanted to get out there, what would it be?
It would be for everybody going through any hard situation to never give up and just focus on all the positive things in this world. There's so much negative that gets talked about all the time, but there's also so much positive that doesn't get talked about. I think it needs to get picked up in the media more, and people need to focus on positive things more than the negative.
Well, you're doing that right now, John. I just know quickly you want to say hi to a few people.
Oh, I want to say hi to my baseball coach, Coach Wetzel, and thank Mike White and the Penguins for everything that they're doing for me, and my neighbors sitting at home watching me here at the game. Let's go Pens!
Nicely done, John. Thanks for sharing your story. Joe, back to you.
Chris, John, we appreciate it. The Chalice family, thanks so much. There's a young man who truly believes he has it all figured out. He's a baseball player, Darren. He likes to play football as well. On his baseball cap underneath, he's got courage plus believe equals life.
Hey, let's just say this. He said, go Pens, go John. Thank you. Inspiration tonight and a positive. What a great hockey game we got going.
A backhander from Sidney Crosby that's gloved by Martin Biron. We are just taking our first steps into this third period. Game number two of the Eastern Conference Final. Philadelphia and Mike Knuble trying to battle back from a 1-0 series deficit. Bested by Jordan Staal and the Pens on Friday night here, 4-2.
Flyers said they'd be better in game two. They believed it. And so far they've delivered, Joe.
2-2 thanks to the Richards shorthanded marker. Sikora feeding Scuderi. Malkin on the head fake, trying to loosen his grip away from Richards. Another big hit. Malone denied down low by Biron. Malkin's backhander did not get through the traffic. Malone stymied. Whoa! And a horse collar was put up. Richards was taken down. Play continues. Richards feeding Umberger with Lupel driving to the crease. The pass never arrived. Ryan Malone scoops it back to center. Joe Beninati, Darren Elliott, Chris Simpson with you tonight. Mellon Arena in Pittsburgh for game two. Wachovia Center on Tuesday night. We'll keep you company for game three. The Flyers would like to go there, having stolen home ice advantage from these Penguins. Pittsburgh, having won its first six in the postseason in this barn, trying to set a franchise playoff winning streak record in the playoffs should they prevail tonight. Crosspool, good look. Stop attempt. Oh, great stop there by Fleury. Danny Briere was cleaned out after he made that backhander. Briere still dangerous. Another rap attempt to the point position for Hatcher.
Good to see that he's healthy. He was a little woozy. Goaltender down. Goaltender interference this time by Briere.
Briere really giving it to the referee. He's going to make the assessment against him. That is the referee, Dan O'Halloran.
Second period, we show you Daniel Briere having a tough time. Getting worked over by Orpik. Goal cam, our Radio Shack goal cam shows you goaltender overboard. As he hits the deck, does Fleury. They're saying it was because of Briere, but that replay seemed to show that Brooks Orpik may have had something to do with it.
And in that little exchange, something every mom out there watching on Mother's Day could appreciate. Those two guys looking palms up at each other and going, he did it. Oh, he did it. And mom has to be judge and jury.
This game has had a little bit of that and an awful lot of controversy. And you don't want to go to the penalty box tonight the way these power plays are clicking, or the shorthanded goal situation. Every goal scored in a special team situation tonight.
Gonchar coordinating the power play for Pittsburgh. Biron snaps it along the glass. He got good mustard on that. And he'll drive Pittsburgh back into its own territory, namely Sidney Crosby to turn with him. Crosby skipping through center. Accelerates at the line. Drops it for Malkin. Board to board, there's Gonchar. Malone on the outside, hemmed in there by Randy Jones. Flyers do not have Braden Coburn tonight. They started the game with him. He was injured early in the first period, will not return. Crosby, it trickles on by him. Sikora looking back for number 87. Smith muscles up. Sikora looking to stop. Knubel took it away but didn't get it clear. Biron has it in the glove. Compliments of Gonchar.
Well, the hitting furious. Hatcher catches Malkin. In that second period, Philadelphia up the ante. Hatcher on Malkin as a team 16-9. Flyers out hit Pittsburgh. In the faceoff circle, they turn around and won 16 of the 25 draws. 16-9, the same numbers in the faceoff circle. So Philadelphia playing a strong hockey game here on the road.
Darian Hatcher given the day off yesterday. John Stevens is wearing him out tonight. Almost 18 minutes in the first two stanzas.
Had to take penalties just to get a rest.
Malkin sets up shot. Straight away, Ryan Whitney. Malkin on the slap pass. Backdoor look. Biron anticipated very, very well. He was ready for Letang.
He certainly was. Biron reading and reacting so confidently here in game two.
Not that he was bad in game one, but Letang had a good little look. Sneak in move in the left point, but
Biron sniffed it out long before the rookie.
Young defenseman, 21-year-old rookie Christopher Letang, had a knack for scoring goals in the third period. He only had a half dozen total on the season, but five of them came late in the game in period three.
Young legs, fresh.
He got there in time, but it took a bad bounce, Letang did. Fleury leaves the crease to play for Ryan Whitney. On the hand ahead for Evgeny Malkin. Malkin splits the seam. Poke checked by Jason Smith, who is waiting for him at the end of the line.
And Crosby frustrated, banging his stick after getting hammered to the boards by Jason Smith behind the play.
You know when you play against the Flyers, and Jason Smith and Darian Hatcher and the likes, that you are going to be in for a very, very physical affair.
Well, you better be genuine when you say that you can match up against that, because it's not going to get any easier. And Philadelphia Flyers have to like the way Pittsburgh's reacting right now, a little bit of petulance to their game. They're not liking being knocked around.
This is Hal Gill motoring to center. A near pickpocket for Upshaw. Knubel does take it away from the big defender. Carter from the sharp angle. Three defenders were waiting to help out Fleury. Carter skids to a stop. Jeff Carter, who picked up a power play goal in this outing tonight. Upshaw rakes it free. Throws it back into traffic for Knubel. He likes it like that. Carter, deep slot, Upshaw block. Knubel there in front. Lost his balance as he was tied up by Scuderi. Marching back through center, Tyler Kennedy. He got in a good dust-up with Scotty Upshaw to start this game tonight. Jarkko Ruutu there.
Hatcher hitting again. He's not just hitting, he's hitting to hurt.
Oh, he's handing out some bruises is what he's doing. Ruutu with Jones draped over top. Wrister coming, good. Glove save, Biron. The rebound trickled away after he stopped Tyler Kennedy. And more commotion at the crease, and Biron is going to get the penalty here.
Ruutu's never going to draw that call.
Better than 17,000 standing and voicing their displeasure here, or actually rooting for Ruutu.
Ruutu gets in with that left leg. He makes sure he got a piece of Biron. Biron decked him. There's nothing really. And then Patrick gets the face wash. And Ruutu gets the 2 minutes for embellishment. And he will get it every time. WWE flop doesn't work in the NHL.
Jarkko Ruutu during the season, only George Larocque with more penalties during the regular campaign. 2-2 in game two, and then Tuesday night, the clash of the Keystone State continues. Game three, the Eastern Conference Final from Philadelphia, 7:30 Eastern time, here on Versus, the national cable home of the Stanley Cup playoffs, and you can bet it'll be a vengeance-filled, code orange group of faithful awaiting at Wachovia Center.
Hartnell, the designated sitter for Martin Biron. Jarkko Ruutu diving, embellishment, unsportsmanlike, but obvious. Still Ruutu. Not there, he's still on the bench.
A disbeliever.
He's going to get another one if he doesn't hurry up, Joe. Like a sit-in? A protest?
Nonverbal protest. Jarkko Ruutu finds himself in the penalty box. Biron also picking up a minor penalty, so we go 4-on-4. Lassi Kukkonen kicks it free. Jason Smith ready to set sail. A control breakout now for Mike Richards.
And maybe I'm showing my goaltender union ties. I think that's the right call. But I think Ruutu meant to get a piece of him. And he's flopping, trying to draw the call. The goaltender pushes him. Put them both in the box and let's go. Play on.
You? Goalie favoritism? Never. Hossa on the drop. Crosby pivots. Gonchar's bid was blocked by Richards. Danny Briere turns it on back. Hossa came to collide with Kukkonen. And now Jason Smith will work his way through center with Mike Richards. Richards angling in, fires that one that was blocked by Orpin. We are 2-2, nearing the midway mark at period three in Pitt.
All tied here in the third period. How did we get there? Well, our acting retellers shows that Evgeny Malkin swimming across the blue line. Oh, he's going to be fancy, is he? Sends it across the blue line. Oh, Mike Richards, though, he's a thoughtful guy himself. He spies it out. Malkin delivers. Richards with the steal and away to the races shorthanded. 23 seconds remaining in the second. We're tied because of that. But a circumstance is brought to you by AccuView.
As the Penguins faithful try to inspire their heroes here on home ice in a 2-2 game with 13:40 to go in regulation time. Hatcher elevates that pass for Modrý. Modrý to the front. Upshaw tracked down by two defenders. Malkin comes roaring back through center. On the drop, Ryan Whitney's wrister, no worries for Biron. Counterattacking, it's Philadelphia's turn to make a break for it. Carter hits the seam. Carter poke checked by Letang.
Here's that pair we talked about, the two offensive-minded defensemen together. They're out in a 4-on-4 situation, Letang and Whitney, but they were paired by Mike Therrien because he wanted them to be committed defensively, not to just rely on their partner as they had throughout the year. So he said, playoffs, guys need challenges. So I challenge them to be committed defensively.
Great shift moments ago by Jeff Carter. He's on the bench, awaiting his next turn. Sergei Gonchar, stiff arms, loophole away. Biron will hold it up. Chooses to play it around himself. And Gonchar with Hartnell leaving the box. Good piece of stick handling there. Maxime Talbot, who's played sparingly tonight, back into the lineup after breaking a foot in that Rangers series in game three. He's wearing protective equipment on both skates tonight. As Loople tries to clear it in, puts it into the open door. Just a little bit after the six-minute mark of this third period, Mike Richards left to go to the Flyer dressing room.
Coming back, skate issue. Taken care of. Portland managers across the league do such a fine job keeping these guys able to play, get on the ice. Great job by the equipment guys.
And they do it in no time, seemingly.
No, and the guys are so particular about their gear. You've got to get it done. Harry Bricker doing the quick turnaround there.
Stall set up by Kennedy. The ricochet winds up on the tape of Danny Briere. Crossbow cleaned out along the boards by Ruutu. Fleury back behind the cage getting into a little bit of hot water, but his mates come to the rescue. And if you're just tuning in with us on a Sunday night, it's 2-2. This is game two of the Eastern Conference Final. Exclusively yours on Versus. Available to you in high definition. Crosby and Hossa have struck for Pittsburgh. Carter and Richards have the goals for Philadelphia. A game that has not featured an even strength strike. everything is either power play or shorthanded.
But if you're Philadelphia, there's so many turnovers in game one. Just five thus far in this game. Magnificent management of the puck.
Larocq badgered there from the blind side. Lucic front. Score! Maxime Talbot delivers the energy.
Puck management. I was saying how good they've been. Steve Downey turns the puck over right there. Flyers turn it over. Nobody comes up with it. It gets deep, and it gets buried. Nice play off the end wall. Gary Roberts, Max Talbot, bad boots and all. Scores a huge goal.
Maxime Talbot, who's on the board for himself in the Ottawa series as the Penguins here are whistled offside. There's John Chalas, the story that we brought to you just a few moments ago. Has to be thrilled with Maxime Talbot's second in the postseason.
And there's Steve Downey as a winger, as a fourth line guy, the guy inserted into the lineup, supposed to be a board battler. Whether it's his fault or not, a bad bounce, doesn't matter. It's his job to get the puck out. It didn't get out. And it ended up in his own net. And you could see his reaction to that. And that time, a flub shot was handled by Biron.
Biron called upon to make his 29th stop.
There it is.
A few moments ago, he didn't get this one.
Well, fumble, stumble. And then Darian Hatcher tries to get there. And then compounded by the fact Downey was flat-footed. Hatcher tried to help him, couldn't get it out either. Now their defensive rotation is all messed up, and a brilliant play on the end wall by Roberts to give Talbot a lot of credit as well, Joe. He went to the spot.
9:51, the time of the goal. Talbot second from Larocq and Roberts. Sidney Crosby was telling us earlier in the day, Pittsburgh's game collectively, first line through fourth line, all the way through the defense pairs, skating game, being on your toes, getting to the right spot. You just use that expression. It pays dividends for Talbot. Crosby now with a wrister that went well wide. Back pressure coming from Mike Richards. Richards lost the handle. Dupuis is there, and Richards comes back to get it. R.J. Umberger, who had some glowing scoring opportunities in game one, has been quiet tonight.
Much quieter. I was thinking the same thing, Joe.
Second in the league in goal scoring behind only the injured Detroit winger Johan Franzen.
Umberger did have a couple of assists. Okay, when there's more work, keeping the guys in.
It's a Pittsburgh team that has really profited in the third period of the postseason.
And that's that skating game again. They feel Philadelphia tries to wear you down a little bit physically. Pittsburgh thinks they can wear you down with their speed.
Offside against Pittsburgh. Just about at the midway mark of the third. And once again, the Philadelphia Flyers have to chase down these Pittsburgh Penguins. This could easily have been an opening round series when you think back to the end of the regular campaign.
Well, many people, Brian Murray in Ottawa, thinking that the Pens didn't go as hard in that last game. And guess what? They probably didn't. It was game 82 on the schedule, and they were set. I don't think they did anything to try to get a contrived matchup. It just fell that way, and it ended up working up very well for both teams anyway.
As it turns out, Philadelphia is the sixth seed, and Pittsburgh the two. Flyers disposing of the Washington Capitals and Montreal Canadiens in the opening two rounds. Pittsburgh taking care of Ottawa and the New York Rangers. Upshaw blazes one right to the blocker of Fleury, and he'll squeeze. The Penguins have the lead at home. Maxime Talbot has something to celebrate. The faithful love it. The bench loves it. Pittsburgh on top.
Penguins on top, 3-2. A costly giveaway, something they've been very good at managing the puck in this game.
our acting retaliator. Stop it right there, guys. Steve Downey had all kinds of time. He has all kinds of support as well with guys right there and there. But watch what happens from there. Fail to get it out. Transition. Stop right there. Come right down the middle. And to get the chance. And simple turnover. Leads to a chance. Gets them all caught. Ends up in the back of the net.
Maxime Talbot, who returns to the lineup after the injury tonight, provides it. Whoa! Great backhand there by Crosby off the crossbar as we go off to Hockey Central. Here's Bill. Much appreciated, Bill. Dallas not able to do what it did in the first two rounds in round three. By that I mean go into the enemy city and win the first two games. Detroit held serve.
Held serve and really held the puck an awful lot, didn't it? Seem like it usually doesn't see Detroit play. Such good puck possession right there through with an easy puck possession, a shot by Upshaw.
You get down to these final four teams. Sidney Crosby threatening the goal here with a backhand.
Nice backhand. Got lots on it. Had their own beat over the crook of the left arm. Off the crossbar and up and out of play.
From a goalie's perspective, why is that so tough? Why are backhands so tough to stop?
You don't know where the release point is going to be. You can see how he sweeps it. You don't know exactly when that puck is going to come off the stick plate.
Talking about the final four teams, Eastern and Western Conference Finals, and in particular, you mentioned the puck possession of Detroit. One skill set that they possess, maybe better than any team in the league, they pass the puck so beautifully.
Never give it up, and that's when you say puck possession, that's a fancy term for a team that passes the puck very well and skates with it. They don't like to give it up. They're not really a dump and chase, but they play with a lot more determination than last year. They're in sync right now, Joe.
Both of these teams tonight, Pittsburgh and Philadelphia, saying, you know, we want the puck to do more of the work. Detroit has it on a yo-yo string sometimes like that.
We watched that game last night on Versus, and Pavel Datsyuk was putting on a clinic just because he could at times. It seemed like it. Just magic in his stick-handling abilities.
Mike Emmerich, Eddie Olczyk, Bob Hart will take over tomorrow as Sikora blasts that one high. 7:50 to go in this one, regulation time. Sikora. Poke checked by Kukkonen. Malkin turning the corner on Briere. Backhander that's blunted by Biron, and he'll squeeze.
Malkin trying to make amends. Biron with a real good read there, because as Malkin went away, a fadeaway on his backhand, there's no way he could elevate the puck. So holding tight to that goalpost, Malkin was snuffed out by Biron's positioning.
His head coach, Michel Therrien, talks about the coaching responsibility of raising the bar. You talked about it, challenging the great players. Michel Therrien has had a very good influence on Malkin in his young career.
And he said when he has the right energy and emotion, he's an excellent player for us. Well, these Pittsburgh Penguins have won 14 straight games at home. All of them here in the playoffs, six of them. And he has 14 goals, Malkin, in those home games. So the energy and enthusiasm of the crowd seems to really benefit him from a leadership standpoint.
Talbot with a wrister. That's blocked by Jason Smith. Talbot to the front, snared by Lukl. Transition game now for R.J. Umberger. Makes the pass to himself off the board. Scuderi came over to help. And this is tapped back to center. 3-2 Pittsburgh. Talbot has the lead goal. His second of the postseason from The Rock and Roberts at 9:51 of this period. Just off the bench, Dupuis will saucer it on back. Both teams in the midst of line changes.
Awful lot of faith Mike Therrien has in that fourth line. You saw them out there again. They scored a big goal. That's a big advantage if you have faith in your fourth line. You get certain matchups coming off of that, especially if Sidney Crosby's guy, Mike Therrien's going to play his fourth line. Now John Stevens probably can't. That means you can sneak Crosby and Malkin then right out after them and get the matchups you want.
Just all part of that chess game. John Stevens patrolling his side. Working without Braden Coburn for the vast majority of this hockey game. Young defender hit by a puck in the first period in the face. will not return tonight.
Played just 1 minute and 7 seconds. I'll show you how early that happened.
After much news has been made about the loss of Kimmo Tiimonen, the blood clot in his ankle taking away arguably the Flyers' best player, top defender. Dupuis with a blast that was muffled. Kukkonen in the battle along the boards. Hartnell is there too. He'll shake it free. It comes all the way down. It's going to be an icy call against Philadelphia.
Touch it, touch it. As soon as I was watching, everyone said to touch it, and I thought you could hear that through the mic. But the clock stopped at 6:01. Anticipating that there was going to be an earlier touch.
Darren, from your vantage point as the Flyers huddle up, Hartnell, Briere, and Prosper so good in the opening round against Washington. How have teams changed their defensive posture against them?
I'm not sure they really have so much that the matchups aren't very good right now. Well, not favorable at all.
Referee O'Halloran over with a word of explanation. It's 3-2 Pittsburgh. More in game two in a moment on Versus.
The Stanley Cup playoffs on Versus are brought to you by Honda Generators, the power of choice. And by Coca-Cola. Stanley Cup playoffs on Versus are brought to you by Honda Generators, the power of choice. And by Coca-Cola Zero, real Coke taste and zero calories.
This series has taken the moniker the Cold War of Pennsylvania. Well, Philadelphia and Pittsburgh, separated by some 5 hours of drive time, will be working west to east ahead for Philly for game three. The question is, will it be a 2-0 series lead for Pittsburgh, or do the Flyers bounce back again and level the count before going to Wachovia Center?
And that looked like a set play off a faceoff win.
Hartnell angled by Gonchar. Malkin defensively makes the play and clears. Even strength in 5-on-5, that is, with 5.5 to go in the third. Prosper gets back on it. Over 30 goals again for Vinny Prosper, combined between Tampa and Philly during the regular year. Prosper pulls the trigger, stick save, Marc-Andre Fleury.
Well, it lines back out there now. Again, the matchups don't seem to be favorable at the center ice position. Much bigger guys are getting Malkin out there awful lot against Daniel Briere. Can't explain why Prosper's been so invisible, other than the fact that he usually needs someone to get him the puck, the centerman. And Hartnell has played his game, I thought, tonight.
Jeff Carter will touch this one into the corner. Gonchar is there, rattled by Upshaw, who loves to work in there on the forecheck. Jordan Staal has some breathing room, closed off by Hatcher. Far flank, it's Kennedy. Sandwiched by Modry and Upshaw. Modry guides it. Carter skates it to safety. Down the wing with Knubel. Knubel's wrister gloved by Fleury. He'll hold.
Game summary. In this one, first power play opportunity. Oh, yes, a goal. Sidney Crosby shorthanded before the second period is about to expire by Mike Richards. We're tied 2-2, and then in here in the third. Even strength, the fourth line capitalizes on a turnover. Max Talbot back in the lineup after breaking his foot. In round one, has a huge goal in this one.
35-30, Pittsburgh leads in terms of shots. This Penguins team best in the postseason in terms of goals against average, 1.90. Biron throws it away. Crosby's in. Head fake. Fires! And a sprawling Biron makes a wonderful glove save.
That's just called redemption, because the turnover, Biron turned the puck over in game one that led to a goal. This is, oh my God, look what I've done. How about that?
thievery, but of his own making. He says feeling pretty good that his team is not down two.
You said redemption. I'll say getting your own butt out of the fire.
Yeah.
Whoa.
That was Sidney Crosby dangling and dancing around the traffic. Desperation dive by Biron. Worked.
That was Jim Dowd entrusted with the defensive zone faceoff responsibilities there, and he won it for Philly.
Pushed immediately to the bench after that, though.
Richards then got mauled by Hal Gill. 3:50 to play, regulation time. Pittsburgh clinging to a one-goal advantage on home ice, trying to set a franchise record and win its seventh straight at home in the playoffs. The 92 Penguins, Stanley Cup winner, managed to win six straight here in this old barn. A mark that's been equaled by the 2008 Pens. LaRocque moseying his way to center. Dumps it in. Michel Therrien is begging for the line change. Hatcher for Crosby. Board to board. Hartnell surrounded by Sikora. Scott Hartnell with determination. Sergei Gonchar clamping onto it for Pittsburgh. And Sikora will carefully get it back for Malkin to touch. Orpik happy to play dump and chase now. Briere tying up Sikora. Jones will reverse, and the Flyer captain, Jason Smith, moves it to center. Fleury thought about going after it in the corner, leaves it for Orpik. Orpik arm-in-arm with Briere. Manny Briere stopped again by Orpik with 2:40 to go in regulation.
And there's that matchup again, though. Malkin so much bigger than Briere, just keeping him neutralized against the end wall.
Malkin with a juggling exhibition, hammered by Prosper. And you watch Mode return with it. Modric, too strong for Carter. We'll keep our eyes peeled on Martin Biron, see when the Flyers will lift him for the extra skater. Kennedy in, fires, tried to go high glove, and missed it by a whisker.
And another turnover, though. Last half of this third period, maybe a little bit fatigue setting in. Philadelphia blue line decimated, undermanned.
Upshaw with plenty of zip down the wing, fires, stopped by Fleury, rebound was there. Carter digging. He sent it wide. Jones creeping in from a point position. That went wide through the screen as Knubel was using that big body in front. 1:45 to go in the third. Game two of the Eastern Conference Final. Exclusively on Versus. Available in high definition. And down the stretch we go. Crosby jetting in there. Umberger slowed him. Digging for it along the wall. Hatcher didn't get it clear. 1:23 to play in the third. Another collision. Richards. His pass off the boot of Umberger. Hossa. Poke checked by Jones. Marian Hossa, man possessed right now. We'll leave it south of that goal line with 65 seconds to go in this third period. That's the time separating Pittsburgh from a 2-0 series lead. Potentially. Zakora's blast denied by Biron. Fans standing. A sellout crowd at Mellon Arena. Biron on his way to the bench. Gill lifts it on the ledge. Not out. High in the air. Fleury will cover and put that glove right in the mush of Joffrey Lupo.
Lupo put himself pretty close to Fleury. And that's a no-no. That'll draw a crowd, and it does. Good hockey game, hard fought.
A few moments ago, it was Scotty Upshaw breezing down the wing.
Lots of long-range shots by Philadelphia. Not a lot of quality scoring chance per se here in the third period. Volkam look at it, Fleury with a save on Upshaw. That man
Jeff
again.
Carter waiting at the Flyers bench. Philadelphia will ask for the timeout.
Take a look.
Without Braden Coburn for the good majority of this game, look at those ice time totals.
Yeah, that's a huge amount for Darren Hatcher. He didn't skate yesterday. John Stevens had a practice, which wasn't customary in the days after the postseason. I thought they had to. Hatcher didn't. Already skated over 10 minutes here in the third period alone. All those guys being asked to do more, and they've done a masterful job for the most part, but they've looked a little fatigued. Energy flagging here in the third period in their own zone. We saw a couple of turnovers come right back at them, a little more flat-footed than they had been.
All of this in advance of Game 3, which comes your way Tuesday. The Keystone State Clash continues. The Eastern Conference Final from Philadelphia, 7:30 Eastern Time Tuesday here on Versus, the national cable home of the Stanley Cup playoffs. The Flyers looking for some late magic to end Game 2. The high-powered Penguins hoping to go to Philadelphia with a 2-0 series lead. For all the men and women in our technical crew, for Darren, for Chris, a happy Mother's Day to one and all those moms out there. Darren's and Chris in particular in Ontario. My mom watching in Arizona. For the final 34 seconds to go in period 3, Stahl trying to seal it. He will. Jordan Stahl, empty netter, 4-2.
The Pens answered. They answered. Jordan Stahl puts a capper on it. But Philadelphia played much better, but will return home down to love for the first time. There's John Chalice. Great finish to a great story here this evening for him.
18-year-old youngster from nearby Freedom, PA. He's battling terminal cancer. His story has been so inspirational for a lot of kids, lots of adults in the area. And he's standing and cheering with all the other Penguins fans. 22 seconds away from taking command of this series 2-0. But you just know the Flyer fans will be ready on Tuesday night. All in orange, upwards of 20,000 of them. Carter blocked by Orpik. 6 seconds now foul. Gonchar will cozy up to it, and this one is in the books. Once again, the final count is 4-2. Marc-Andre Fleury with 30 stops. Pittsburgh gets the job done, sets a franchise record with their 7th straight postseason win here in this barn. And they are the first team since the 95 Red Wings to open a postseason 10-1. John Stevens makes his way to the dressing room. Flyers will have Game 3 on Tuesday in their barn at Wachovia Center. And they've got some catching up to do. Once again, your final score tonight. Pittsburgh 4 and the Flyers 2 in Game 2 of the Eastern Conference Finals. For Chris Simpson, for Darren Elliott, for all the men and women in our technical crew, Joe Beninati, thanks for your time. The Penguins continue to be too tough on home ice as we get you to Hockey Central, presented by Bud Light. Back to the studio. Here now, Bill Patrick.